Finality, motions for reconsideration on the controversial Anti-Terrorism Act.
Authorities arrest three suspects linked to the security breach of the Philippine Paul Body's tech provider, Smartmatic.
Former U.S. President Donald Trump held in contempt for failing to produce documents in connection with a New York court's probe into his company.
And Russia warns the conflict in Ukraine could trigger a third world war.
Good evening, I'm Tony Velasquez.
And I'm Pia Gutierrez.
On our broadcast tonight, the Philippine Supreme Court deals a final blow to petitions against the country's controversial anti-terrorism law. It upheld its own ruling last year, which kept the measure mostly intact. Mike Navallo has tonight's top story.
Supreme Court magistrates sealed the fate of petitions against the Anti-Terrorism Act on Tuesday by junking all six motions for reconsideration filed by petitioners. In an unbacked meeting in Baguio City, the High Court denied the motions due to lack of substantial issues and arguments raised by petitioners. Various groups have asked the High Court to reconsider its December ruling, which left mostly intact the highly contested measure, except for two parts. First, a proviso under Section 4, which exempts exercises of civil and political rights, such as protests, from being considered acts of terrorism as long as they are not intended to cause death, serious physical harm, or endanger a person's life, or create serious risk to public safety. A second provision struck down is the second mode for designating terrorists under Section 25, which allows the Anti-Terrorism Council to adopt requests for designations by other countries or international bodies if they follow the criteria set by United Nations Security Council resolution. But petitioners wanted more provisions voided, such as Section 4 on the definition of terrorism, Section 9 on inciting to commit terrorism, Section 10, which punishes recruitment and membership in a terrorist organization, Section 12 on providing material support to terrorists, and Section 29 on warrantless arrest and extended period of detention. One closely contested provision is Section 25, which grants the Anti-Terrorism Council the power to designate terrorists on the basis of its own finding of probable cause, which could lead to freezing of assets. It barely passed scrutiny with a vote of 8-7, with Justice Carandang voting to declare the provision unconstitutional, but was outvoted. It is not immediately clear how her replacement, Justice Antonio Coe Jr., voted, as no breakdown was provided to the media. But according to the Supreme Court, Coe sided with the majority, while the other justices maintained their votes. A copy of the resolution has yet to be released. Malacanang welcomed the ruling, calling it a triumph for all peace-loving and law-abiding Filipinos, as it supposedly serves a stern warning that the Philippines is not a safe haven for terrorists. But the National Union of People's Lawyers, who acted as counsel for petitioner Bayan, says they are downhearted by the ruling. Although they remain optimistic, the law will be struck down, amended, or repealed ultimately. The Free Legal Assistance Group still maintains the vague definition of terrorism and the grant of broad powers to the Anti-Terrorism Council are dangerous, prone to abuse, and violative of the Constitution. Rights Group Alliance Karapatan warns the Supreme Court ruling will only engender commission of human rights violations, calling on candidates to take a stand on this issue and call for the junking of the anti-terror law. The denial of the motions with finality means the Supreme Court will no longer entertain additional arguments and pleadings on the issue. But the December ruling said it's possible to challenge the remaining provisions of the Anti-Terrorism Act once these are applied to specific cases. Mike Navallo, ABS-CBN News, Baguio City.
Philippine police arrest several suspects allegedly behind a breach in the automated system of the Election Commission's technology contractor. Zian Ambrosio with the details.
Agents of the Philippine National Police's Anti-Cybercrime Group and the Cybercrime Investigation and Coordinating Center conducted a sting operation in this apartment in Imus, Cavite on Sunday, April 24th. That's after operatives received a tip that two of three hackers allegedly behind a data breach involving Smartmatic were operating here. Smartmatic is the Commission on Elections' automated poll technology provider. The two suspects, a 21-year-old and an 18-year-old, were nabbed after accepting 10 million pesos as down payment from an intelligence operative who pretended to be working for an election candidate. The third suspect, the group's alleged mastermind, identified as Jeffrey Limpiago, was arrested in Santa Rosa, Laguna in a follow-up operation.
Siyang huling tumanggap ng actually bodel money, no? Ng 10 million. Kasi humingi nga ng 60 million. Pero initial down payment ng 10 million, kaya nilang i-manipulate ang resulta ng eleksyon at humingi ng bayad. At ito naman ay inoperate ng ating mga IT operatives. Karoon ng 3 meetings.
According to the CICC, which is an attached agency of the Department of Information and Communications Technology, the hackers were able to breach Smartmatic system.
Naghanap sila ng mga kandidato na sumasang-ayon sa kanilang mga plano na mag-hack at papanalunin. Ayaw namin manggitin ang mga pangalan at probinsya.
The suspects are now facing cases for violation of the Cybercrime Prevention Act.
Na-file na namin ang kaso na system interference, illegal access, at saka yung attempt in the commission of cybercrime.
CICC Executive Director Cesar Mancao confirmed the group is connected to former Smartmatic employee Ricardo Argana, who has already been investigated for a security breach at the firm.
Connected ito doon sa nahuling, unang nagsuko na si Ricardo Argana, na ngayon ay hindi na mahanap. Subalit, sa kanyang pagtatago ngayon, ay putol na yung access niya dahil binigay na niya dito sa isa.
Back in a Senate hearing in January, Mancao already told lawmakers that Smartmatic system has been compromised, but he withheld proof at that time. In that same hearing, COMELEC Commissioner Marlon Casquejo insisted that even if the system was compromised, it will not have an effect on the May 9 elections because it doesn't involve sensitive information. Z. Ana Brosho, ABS-CBN News.
Philippine poll official Ray Bulay unapologetic for his controversial warning to anyone who may cause unrest or violence during the May elections. Bulay insists his remarks were given a wrong spin by the media and that he's the victim in this controversy. More in this report.
Philippine Election Commissioner Ray Bulay blames the media after getting flack over a remark he issued against critics of the poll body. Bulay told ANC he did not threaten to arrest the critics. He reiterates he only issued a warning to those planning to resort to violence if they don't get their desired outcome.
I never said anything wrong.
You said
I'm not taking anything back. It was the spin on my statement that made everything wrong. Mm. And it is done with malice. With malice and with publication. May karuktong yun, huwag natin sanang putulin yung karuktong. Mm. Kapag nanggulo kayo
okay
sa resulta ng eleksyon na ito. Kung ang resulta ng eleksyon ay ginulo dahil doon sa statement na minamind condition mo ang mga tao na kapag natalo, dinaya. At yung mga kakampi na mga yun o mga kaanig, yung word, wala akong ibig sabihin doon. Yung mga kasagpi ng mga yon, ang tingin nga nila dinaya ng gulo ng eleksyon, ay dadamputin yung mga yon.
Several election watchdogs and lawyers groups have slammed Bulay's earlier statement, saying it impinged on the public's freedom of expression. But Bulay isn't backing down.
I was defamed. They said that I threatened to jail critics. Identifiability of the victim. Eh, naka-plaster yung picture ko doon sa headline.
So you consider yourself as a victim in this situation?
Of course. Am I not?
The Philippine Election Commission sets strict controls on its planned panel interviews of presidential and vice presidential bets. The poll body says the choice of panel members and their questions will need its approval. COMELEC Commissioner George Garcia says their partnership with the country's Association of Broadcasters may be finalized by Wednesday. Garcia also responded to doubts raised by VP Bet, Walden Bellio over the poll body's competence in organizing debates and the elections in general.
Pag-hold po ng debate ay different matter sa pag-hold ng eleksyon. Wala naman po may kagustuhan dito sa pangyayaring ito. Siyempre po, ito ay kahit paano dungis, kahit ganong kaliit sa integridad po ng Commission ng Eleksyon. At kami nga po ay humihingi talaga ng paumanhin sa nangyari.
COMELEC Commissioner Ray Bulay insists the poll body owes nothing to its debate organizer, Impact Hub Manila. Bulay says the COMELEC cannot grant the 15 million peso payout request by poll officials to Impact Hub since the commission's contract with the firm is free. The COMELEC had to cancel the last leg of its planned election debates over the weekend after Impact Hub failed to pay the venue Sofitel Philippine Plaza. Bulay says the COMELEC cannot pay the hotel with funds from the poll body's budget for voters' education.
No, I'm sorry, that will be technical malversation. I find no commission resolution offering to pay them, nor do we have the authority to pay them. Sofitel is in contract with
Impact Hub.
Meanwhile, COMELEC Commissioner George Garcia says Impact Hub Manila has not responded to his request to submit a letter explaining why it failed to pay Sofitel.
From the vice presidential bet, Lito Atienza lambasts the Philippine poll body after he encountered issues with the agency's online precinct finder. The House Deputy Speaker and three-time Manila Mayor said he had his staff check his voter's status using the website, only to find out that his name is missing in his poll precinct in Manila. Atienza believes this could be a move to disenfranchise voters and cheat in the upcoming polls.
Lumalabas, hindi ako rehistrado ron. Ito po hindi bagong pandaraya. Luman-luma na ito sa kasaysayan ng mga mandarambong sa politika.
Atienza adds he wants the matter to be investigated.
Another daughter of the Philippine Vice President asks the National Bureau of Investigation to trace the creators of malicious online posts against her. A lawyer for Dr. Tricia Robredo wrote to the NBI Cybercrime Division and listed the possible cyber crimes targeting her. Dr. Robredo's sister Aika had earlier asked the NBI to probe websites which uploaded fake lewd videos that purportedly featured her. The NBI has already identified some of the administrators who created the malicious posts against Aika. The Bureau says it will send them letters to take down the posts.
The so-called Kusi wing of the Philippines ruling party PDP Laban to join forces with the unity team of presidential bet Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos and his running mate Sara Duterte. PDP Laban released a poster hinting President Duterte could join their campaign sorties. The president has yet to name his preferred successor, but he has endorsed 17 senatorial candidates, most of whom were from the PDP Laban Kusi wing and the unity team. The PDP Laban Kusi wing has endorsed Marcos for the presidency, while they adopted Duterte's daughter as their vice presidential candidate.
A faction of the Partido Federal ng Pilipinas breaks away from presidential bet Manila Mayor Isko Moreno and now endorses Vice President Lenny Robredo. The faction's chairman, Abubakar Mangelen, says they informed Moreno's camp of their evaluation of other presidential bets before eventually backing Robredo's candidacy. The faction earlier expressed confidence in Robredo's leadership and her competence to lead the country out of the pandemic. Several volunteer groups, including Ikaw Muna Pilipinas, have also shifted their support from Moreno to Robredo.
This is a party decision that we had with the Partido Federal Pilipinas endorsing Vice President Lenny for her presidency. This is a party decision, I have said, because of several polls from different sectors, no? Different civil society groups and parallel organizations. This is purely voluntary and unconditional.
Progressive Coalition Makabayan unveils the list of senatorial candidates it will support in the May 9 elections. The candidates include former Ifugao Representative Teddy Bagilat, former Vice President Jejomar Binay, Senator Leila De Lima, Human Rights Defender Attorney Shell Jocno, Sorsogon Governor Cheese Escudero, Attorney Luke Espiritu, Senator Risa Hontiveros, Attorney Alex Lacson, Antique Representative Loren Legarda, and Labor Leader Sonny Matula. The list is on top of two senatorial bets they previously endorsed, Nery Colmenares and Bong Labog. Makabayan President Saturo Campos says these candidates share a common stand with the coalition on various issues. Ocampo has this to say about those who criticized their lineup for including candidates who have already been part of the system the group is trying to reform.
Philippine politics is not moving on a straight line. And politicians tend to be pragmatic in certain instances. But there are basic principles, there are basic issues on which the Makabayan has been consistently advocating, with which they concur with us. We are not looking after people who are completely thinking along with us, but who share only certain portions of our advocacies strong enough to consider them as possible allies should they be elected to the Senate.
Here's our Tuesday brief on the Philippine campaign trail. Former Senator Bongbong Marcos holds a press briefing for the first time since the campaign period began. Marcos spoke in Cagayan de Oro about his plans to boost cooperation between the government and the private sector to help small businesses affected by the pandemic. He also vowed support for the agriculture sector. Marcos also wooed voters in Lanao del Norte. Vice President Lenny Robredo pledged support for fishermen, farmers, and other sectors during a visit to Occidental Mindoro. Robredo was supposed to join a campaign rally of Cebu gubernatorial candidate Ace Durano in Talisay City. But her appearance was canceled after Durano said his party decided to endorse Marcos. Manila Mayor Isko Moreno goes to Panay Island. He received a warm welcome from Aklan residents, even as some local officials of the province are supporting other candidates. Moreno is optimistic he can still pull a surprise victory in the May 9 polls.
Also on Tuesday, Senator Panfilo Lacson took his presidential campaign to Abra Province. Lacson denied reports there are attempts to prevent him from visiting the north, the known bailiwick of his rival Bongbong Marcos. He also met with Partido Reforma local officials who continue to back him despite the party dropping him as its standard bearer. Senator Manny Pacquiao begins his tour of Eastern Visayas. His visit in Northern Samar drew a large crowd despite the rains. Pacquiao also met with the province's Governor Edwin Ong Chuan and other local officials. Social media giant Facebook urged to explain its takedown of posts by several Philippine government officials. Senator Ramon Bong Revilla wrote to Facebook's country director John Rubio on Tuesday. He cries censorship over the move, citing how this could have implications on the country's security and sovereignty. Revilla also suggests politics could be behind the social media platform's actions. Revilla is the chairman of the Senate Committee on Public Information and Mass Media. Facebook last week warned National Security Advisor Hermogenes Esperon over his post that claimed communist insurgents have infiltrated Congress.
Social media giant Facebook restores the account of attorney Vic Rodriguez, the spokesperson and chief of staff of presidential candidate Bongbong Marcos. Facebook's parent company Meta has explained the account was mistakenly restricted for reasons unrelated to any content that attorney Rodriguez posted. He thanked lawmakers and other personalities who stood behind him after Meta suspended his account. Rodriguez earlier claimed the suspension was due to his support for Marcos and called it censorship to the highest degree. Up next, the UN chief travels to Russia to seek an end to its attacks on Ukraine.
The World Tonight returns after the break.
The is Wednesday.
Bilang dancers na rin kami.
Sumabay sa winner moves ni na Mamshi Rufa at Nicole Cordobes.
Nahirapan si Maymay. Sumabay sa atin.
Samahan ng super aliw na chika. Achieve natin ang happiness.
Pagkaro meron kang boyfriend na lawyer, parang wala kang panalo.
Ay hindi, I'm always right.
Alam mo, ang galing mo sumagot.
Pwede ka mag-beauty queen.
Sila nagiging Annabelle Raman na rin ako eh. Sino naman yan? Collect and collect and then select.
Magandang buhay!
Silang kumakayod para sa pag-unlad ng bayan ang dapat na mapakinggan ngayong halalan.
Sana ang magiging leader natin ay maging huwaran sila ng bawat Pilipino.
Kailangan talaga na may taglay silang kabutihan.
Siya yung nagbibigay sa amin ng hope para magtrabaho lalo.
Boses ng manggagawang Pilipino, gabay natin sa pagboto.
Tinola, for my future pilot, di kinain yung gulay?
Dapat kasi may Nord Chicken Cubes. May sarap ng isang buong manok na matagal na pinakuluan sa isang cube. Nanunuot ang sarap hanggang sa gulay.
Take two!
Going delicious and nutritious with Nord.
Tsaka na ang conditioner. Pwede na tong shampoo. Bakit ang tsaka ng hair ko?
Ang dry! Hindi pwedeng tsaka na ang conditioner.
Mag-cream silk araw-araw.
See the difference for gandang sigla hair. Mag-cream silk araw-araw.
Tinola, for my future pilot, di kinain yung gulay?
Dapat kasi may Nord Chicken Cubes. May sarap ng isang buong manok na matagal na pinakuluan sa isang cube. Nanunuot ang sarap hanggang sa gulay.
Take two!
Going delicious and nutritious with Nord.
Tsaka na ang conditioner? Pwede na tong shampoo. Bakit ang tsaka ng hair ko?
Ang dry! Hindi pwedeng tsaka na ang conditioner.
Mag-cream silk araw-araw.
See the difference for gandang sigla hair. Mag-cream silk araw-araw.
Tinola, for my future pilot, di kinain yung gulay?
Dapat kasi may Nord Chicken Cubes. May sarap ng isang buong manok na matagal na pinakuluan sa isang cube. Nanunuot ang sarap hanggang sa gulay.
Take two!
Going delicious and nutritious with Nord.
Ngayong halalan 2022, at dito tayo kasama ang mga katuwang sa paglilingkod at pagbabantay at paghahatid ng mga pinakahuling pangyayari sa ating bayan. Andito ang bagong henerasyon ng mas mapanuring mga kabataan. Andito ang mga kasama sa pagtataguyod ng maunlad na kabuhayan. Andito ang mga pinagkakatiwalaan sa pagbabantay ng kaayusan. Andito ang mga kasamahan sa paghahatid ng tamang impormasyon sa bawat tahanan. Andito tayo sa mas pinalakas na sama-samang paglilingkod ngayong halalan 2022!
Tinola, for my future pilot, di kinain yung gulay?
Dapat kasi may Nord Chicken Cubes. May sarap ng isang buong manok na matagal na pinakuluan sa isang cube. Nanunuot ang sarap hanggang sa gulay.
Take two!
Going delicious and nutritious with Nord.
Let's share the love. Shop for a cause at the Metro Benefit Sale. At tulong-tulong sa Pag-ahon fundraising activity for the victims of Typhoon Odette. The proceeds of the 8-day sale will help provide home repair kits to the families still recovering from the super typhoon. Visit MetroBenefitSale.com from April 23 to 30 to avail of exclusive and limited offers of products, services, and experiences from various lifestyle brands. Metro Benefit Sale.
Back on the world tonight, researchers in the Philippines warn of a possible resurgence of COVID-19 cases in the country. That's amid the threat of Omicron subvariants, which are already fueling a spike in cases in other nations. Rafael Bosano reports.
The Omicron variant was responsible for the recent surge in cases in the Philippines. But while the situation was quickly resolved, sublineages of the same variant are currently causing a slight increase in infections. Health experts warn of a possible spike in the coming months, and one way of avoiding this is for the eligible population to get a booster jab. Molecular biologist and Octa fellow Father Nicanor Austriaco explains why these sublineages are a cause for concern.
In South Africa, they're beginning to see
a spike in cases. And this is from all of the reports in the last week. It appears that this increase, this spike, is driven by BA.4 and BA.5, because BA.4 and BA.5 can outcompete BA.2.
Omicron's BA.2 variant is currently predominant in the country. However, BA.4 and BA.5 poses mutations that allow the virus to evade immunity provided by the vaccines and previous infection. Fortunately, there is still no significant increase in hospitalizations.
BA.4 and BA.5 are more transmissible than BA.2, but not more deadly. It is likely that they will lead to an increase in cases. The cases will go up. They will be higher than the 300 per day that we have, but not to an increase in hospitalization.
Aside from BA.4 and BA.5, another sublineage, BA.2.12.1, has been detected in the United States. Like all other variants of concern, there is a possibility these sublineages could enter the Philippines, especially now that the country's borders have opened to foreign travelers. This is why the public is reminded to strictly observe health protocols, as the health department observes a positive 2-week growth rate in 19 areas. Health Secretary Francisco Duque, however, notes other COVID metrics remain low.
Those 19 areas which have been observed to show a 2-week growth rate, positive 2-week growth rate, their ADAR, their average daily attack rate, is even less than 1. Eh, yung para yan maging moderate, from low to moderate risk, kailangan between 6 and 18 per day per 100,000 population. Eh, baba. Diba? It's not even less than 6. It's less than 1.
Rafael Bosano, ABS-CBN News.
The specter of World War III raised by Russia after top U.S. officials visit Ukraine. Moscow's top diplomat Sergei Lavrov blames NATO for essentially being at war with Russia by providing arms to Ukraine's forces. Lavrov warns there's a considerable risk Russia's war with Ukraine will escalate into a nuclear conflict.
Here are updates on the conflict in Ukraine. United Nations Secretary General Antonio Guterres is in Moscow as he seeks to end the fighting in Ukraine. During a meeting with Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov, Guterres said he wants to create the conditions for an effective dialogue and an eventual ceasefire as soon as possible. He is also expected to meet with Russian President Vladimir Putin. From Moscow, the UN chief will next head to Ukraine and meet with President Volodymyr Zelensky.
Billionaire Elon Musk, now officially the new owner of microblogging site Twitter. This development drew mixed reactions among politicians in the U.S. Details in this report.
After weeks of speculations, Tesla boss Elon Musk finally strikes a deal to buy Twitter. The price tag, roughly $44 billion. In a statement, Musk said, "Free speech is the bedrock of a functioning democracy, and Twitter is the digital town square where important matters are debated." He added he wants to make Twitter better with new features, including defeating spam bots. Twitter CEO Parag Agrawal admits the future of the social media firm is uncertain after the deal with Elon Musk. But Twitter did say there were no plans for layoffs, and the agreement with Musk prioritized continuity in Twitter's operations. U.S. Republican lawmakers welcomed the news of Elon Musk's Twitter takeover. Republican Representative Jim Jordan says free speech is making a comeback. Republican Senator Marsha Blackburn, meanwhile, says she hopes Musk will help rein in big tech's supposed history of censoring users that have a different viewpoint. Republicans have been critical of Twitter for banning former U.S. President Donald Trump and other notable conservatives. But Trump himself told Fox News he will not be returning to the social media platform. The Republican leader said he will instead be using his own site, Truth Social. But for Democratic Senator Elizabeth Warren, the move is dangerous for the U.S. She points out billionaires like Musk play by a different set of rules. The White House refuses to comment on the transaction, but it maintains President Joe Biden remains concerned about the power that large social media companies holds.
Our concerns are not new. We've long talked about, and the president has long talked about, his concerns about the power of social media platforms, including Twitter and others, to spread misinformation, disinformation, the need for these platforms to be held accountable.
A New York judge holds former President Trump in contempt for failing to turn over documents in connection with an investigation into his business practices. Trump was ordered to pay a $10,000 fine per day until he complies. Trump's lawyer said they would appeal the ruling. Trump tried but failed in his bid to quash a subpoena on his company's documents that had a March 31 deadline. Trump is being probed on the suspicion his company misdeclared the values of its real estate properties to obtain favorable loans and tax deductions.
The PSE index gives up Monday's gains and falls back to the 6,900 level as investors weigh comments from Philippine officials. Rain Musgi reports.
Philippine shares and in negative territory on Tuesday, the main index now back below the 7,000 level after shedding 0.6%, while the rest of Asia was mixed. Value turnover remained thin at 4.1 billion pesos and foreign selling continued. First Resources Management and Securities says investors reacted to reports that the amendment of the oil deregulation law will be unlikely during the last 2 months of President Duterte's term. The decline also comes after Philippine Central Bank Governor Benjamin Diokno said the country may consider a rate hike in June. BPI Securities' Haj Narvaez acknowledges that while there remains a lot of liquidity in the market and some investors are taking advantage of the volatility, sentiment is cautious.
We always advise investors to take a long-term view. But definitely, I would, you know, my sense is speaking to investors, there's more of a wait-and-see approach. And it's really not being helped by what's happening externally, inflation concerns. And, you know, not just inflation going up, but there's a concern that will inflation eventually impact economic growth, right? Sentiment generally remains more negative than in the past.
Meanwhile, Emperador finished almost 2% higher before settling back at 19 pesos and 20 centavos per share after reporting its 2021 profit grew 35% to 10.8 billion pesos. The largest global brandy company attributed the gains to sales growth due to higher margins. But Union Bank shares dropped 4.5% after the company reported a net income that's 45% lower year on year. UBP cited extraordinary trading gains in the first quarter of 2021. Rain Musngi, ABS-CBN News.
Our final word tonight is a quote from Bruce Lee. Mistakes are always forgivable if one has the courage to admit them.
And that is The World Tonight, the 26th of April, 2022. I'm Pia Gutierrez.
I'm Tony Velasquez from the Philippines. Thank you. Mabuhay!